Okay, hello. Hi, good morning. Well, this is fun. Normally I'm here doing worship and it's gonna be a little bit different today. Sorry, let me get situated here. I think it's so funny how everyone's talking about how cold it is. Wow. So for those of you who don't know, who may be new here today, I live in Montana and it was negative 42 when I left yesterday. So I feel great. I feel absolutely just wonderful here in this warm weather. Y'all have gone soft. That's what's happened. You can come, you know, spend a little time in Montana and find out what real cold is like. It's actually kind of crazy, you know. It's like 15 minutes exposed skin in those negative temperatures. You can get frostbite so fast. And you step outside just to walk, like, from the store to your car, and your skin that's exposed instantly starts burning. And you get instant icicles on your in your nose, in your nose hairs, in your eyelashes, in your eyebrows. And actually, my first winter in Montana, I thought, what are the little tiny bugs that live here in the winter that, like, fly into your nose? How are bugs even alive right now? And are they running towards my nose to escape the cold? Because every time I stepped out in the cold, I felt this tingly, like a little bug flew up my nose. And it took me a while, and I finally figured out that that was my nose hairs freezing. And then when I learned that, I was appalled that I had nose hairs. I thought only my grandpa had those. So, I got a quick education upon our moving there. All right, I'm gonna pray really quick before we get started into this fun time. God, thank you so much for this opportunity to speak about who you are and what you have done. And God, I know that when we share our testimony, when we declare your goodness and your kindness, that there is power in that moment and that you are moving on hearts. I know that when we declare what you have done for us, that you are laying an invitation for others to step into that as well, to say, I did it for one, I can do it for you. And God, I just ask that today, Lord, I love it says in Revelation that they overcame him, talking about the enemy, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Our testimonies are so powerful. And God, I just ask today that as I am sharing my testimony, what you have done in my life, that you would move in this room, move on hearts, Holy Spirit, and that you would bring freedom and you would bring breakthrough and an encounter with your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. Well, I'm gonna start at the beginning. My mom was a waitress at a truck stop when she was about 17 years old, and she met my dad, who was a bad boy biker who frequented the truck stop. And he lived on a farm, he was raised on a farm, he was a country boy who loved his motorcycle. And they met, they got married, and she was 18. She had, Yes, they got married, she was 18, and she turned 19 right after they got married, and I showed up just a few months after that. And my mom, she was a very young mom, obviously, she had me at 19 years old, and my mom had been raised as a Christian by a pastor and his wife, and she grew up in the church, and when she married my dad, I think that all of her faith was really tested. My dad got in a really severe motorcycle wreck when I was 2 years old, and he was in a coma. He had really severe brain damage. The doctors did not believe that he would wake from that coma, and he did. He stunned them all. And when he came out of that coma, he was a different person. And I don't know if you've ever been around anyone who has gone through a really severe brain injury, but there's a process of healing that the brain goes through when it's trying to heal itself after such destruction. And there's like these stages. The doctor kind of explained it, because let me fast forward for just a second. He ended up getting in another motorcycle wreck years later when I was a teenager. And the doctor at that time explained these stages to us. And it's almost like these wide range of emotions, except really big. So there would be moments of just, he's just angry, and he's just raging angry, and everything makes him mad, and he's screaming and kind of violent and raging. And then there'd suddenly be this phase of sadness and grief and crying over everything and hopelessness. And then there was this stage of fear and paranoia and weird stuff, and people are following me, and you know, all these different kind of stages. And it's almost like the brain kind of short-circuiting while it's trying to heal. But my mom, just again being young, she was pregnant with her second daughter, having a two-year-old, walking through all this, it was just too much. And things in the home were not good. They divorced when I was 4 years old. And at that time, my life became kind of split up between two worlds. The world with my mom and the visitations with my dad out on a farm in the country. Now, let me tell you a little bit about my mom. My mom was a singer. She grew up singing. She was in a band for a while when I was young. And this is the 80s, and this is when MTV came out. And my mom, of course, being young, loving music, she was all about MTV and the pop music that was on there. And so when I was little and growing up, I wasn't watching cartoons. I was watching MTV. I was watching all the top pop videos. I loved me some Whitney Houston. Oh, I wanna dance with somebody. Oh my gosh, I could get down to that song. Every time. It was my favorite. And I had this kind of world with my mom and all the exposure to the pop music. And then I would go with my dad in a country farm out in the sticks. And my dad was just pure redneck. And I had all the country music with him and all the dirt, fishing. My dad taught me all about guns, I mean, hunting. We did all the things, archery, all of it. And it's funny because out of all of the exposure to the music and everything that I was gleaning in that time, my absolute favorite song was a country song by a band called Nitty Gritty Dirt Band. There's a yellow moon coming up tonight, shining through the trees. Crickets are singing and lightning bugs are floating on a breeze. Baby, get ready. Cross the field where the creek turns back by the old stump road. I'm gonna take you to a special place that nobody knows. Baby, get ready. Fishing in the dark, lie on our backs and count the stars where the cool grass grows. Down by the river in the full moonlight, we'll be falling in love in the middle of the night, just moving slow. Spring is almost over and the summer's come and the days are getting long. Waited all winter for the time to be right just to take you along. Baby, get ready. It don't matter if we sit forever and the fish don't bite. Jump in the river and cool ourselves from the heat of the night. Baby, get ready. Fishing in the dark, lie on our backs and count the stars where the cool grass grows. Down by the river in the full moonlight, we'll be falling in love in the middle of the night, just moving slow. Fishing in the dark, lie on our backs and count the stars where the cool grass grows.
full moonlight. We'll be falling in love in the middle of the night, just moving slow. Staying the whole night through, feels so good to be with you.
Bet you didn't see that one coming. Country song at church. Feels right to me, actually. It's how we do it in Montana. So my mom went on to get married to another man, and I had two stepfathers, and they were really abusive. My mom kind of had this thing inside of her where I think she thought that she could fix them or change them, help them, save them, something. And these men had a lot of problems and a lot of issues. And I remember, actually, as a young girl, going to visit my grandma, and I would process some of my feelings sometimes with my grandma. And I remember that at a very young age, even I could recognize, you cannot change someone. I didn't actually know at that time what could. I do now. But I didn't know, and I remember telling my grandma, I think that mom thinks that she can change them, but she can't change them. I don't think that we can change people. And I was feeling a lot of big emotions as a young child. I was starting to obviously feel a lot of pain and hurt at the abuse that I was walking through, but also there was an anger that was starting to come up inside of me. And I was really protective of my little sister. My second stepdad, who would get really violent and really physical, when he was kind of on his rampage, I would take my sister and I would hide her somewhere. And I would go and make sure that I was somewhere around him so that he would take it out on me and not hurt my sister. And there was one time that I actually got the courage, and I got so angry that I actually tried to come at him to fight back. And I regretted that really quick because of what he did to me. But the abuse that I was walking through, the pain, the anger, and everything was compounding inside of me. And you know, we would go to church sometimes on a Sunday, and I didn't really know what to think about church. I didn't know what to think about God. I don't know that I could have even told you who Jesus is. I remember going with my grandma on Easter Sunday to watch the big Easter production. And I remember as a little girl crying when Jesus would come walking down the aisle bearing the cross, and the soldiers are whipping him. And I'd say, what are they doing to that man? I couldn't understand, you know, what was happening, or what this was all about, or what it was for. And I just kind of had this thought in my head, like, I think that if you want to be good or you want to appear good, you go to church on Sunday. I thought it was just kind of a thing that good people did. And I didn't really understand that there was anything beyond that. And the idea of God was a little disturbing to me, because it's hard for me to fathom that there could be a God up there when I was a young child walking through suffering and going through abuse. And it was something that I couldn't really reconcile within myself, and I didn't really want to even face that. I didn't even want to entertain those questions of, is there God and is he real? Because if that's true, what does that say about me and about my life and about what I'm dealing with right now? And after my mom had divorced her third husband, but my second stepdad, he left, actually, and they divorced later. But when he left, we had no money. We were very poor. I remember we came home one winter, and my mom had picked us up from daycare and after school care, and we came home, and it was the middle of winter. There's tons of snow. I grew up in a little farming community in southeastern Oregon, and there you could see your breath in our house. There was no heat. Everything had been turned off, all the power, all the heat, like nothing, because my mom couldn't pay the bills. And my mom was crying, and she felt terrible, and she took us to a friend's house, and we ended up staying with a friend. When we finally moved out into a place that my mom could afford as a single mom with her now three children, I had a little brother at that time, little baby brother, and we were in this place where the floors were so rotten that mushrooms were growing out of the floors. And it was infested with mice. My mom would set the traps, and she was so terrified of mice that I would come home from school and I would have to be the one to empty all the traps because my mom just could not handle it. And I just so badly wanted to help my mom. I had this thing inside of me. Despite everything, I wasn't carrying any kind of anger towards my mother. I actually felt like it was my job and my role to protect her, to look out for her, to take care of her. I wanted to help her. I wanted to take care of her. I was really carrying a burden for my mother. And so I wasn't upset about having to do any of this. And I just so badly wanted to just take care of my mom and protect her. And it became summer, and my mom, being a single mom at this time, needed something to do with her kids because she's working. And single moms in the summertime when kids aren't in school, it's like, well, now what are we going to do with them? And she was always trying to find places to send us and things like that. I remember we were so poor. I remember one time I split a can of green beans for dinner with me and my brother and sister. And I was just trying just to help them as much as I can, which, by the way, side note, programs that provide meals for kids in the summertime are so essential. I got free breakfast and free lunch at school, and summertime was a nightmare because we didn't have that anymore. That's just a side note, I'm going to say. Thank God for those ministries that do that. But anyway, my mom finds out that there's a church camp happening, and she decides to send us to this church camp, and it's a week long, and we don't go to this church. We don't know this church. We don't know these people, but she signs me and my sister up to go to this church camp. It's called Camp Corley in Oregon, and sends us, and I did not know this at the time, and I wouldn't have even had these words or this language, but it was Pentecostal. Okay? Do you know what that means? That's the holy rollers. Those kids, they were flopping on the floor and speaking a weird language. So we get sent to this camp, and every night they give this, the preacher would give this big message, and the kids would respond, and they'd go up to the front, and I'd see these children with their hands raised and crying, and they're shaking, and they're falling over, and they're speaking in tongues. I didn't know that at the time, but some language. And me and my sister were like, what a bunch of weirdos. And we're like, get me out of here. And so every night, just as the preaching was wrapping up, we would sneak out the back and go back to our cabin and just hide in our cabin, waiting for it to be over with. And when all that was done, we would they'd open up the snack shop, and we'd be so excited about just going to the snack shop and getting snacks, you know. And so we would just sit in the cabin. But on the last night, the very last night of camp, me and my sister go back to the cabin, but it was different this time. We sat in silence. Normally, we'd be just chatting, but this time we were just sitting there in quiet. And I felt something inside of me, a stirring. And I was like, there is something that those kids have, and I want it. I don't know what it is, but I feel hungry for it. And I was so scared. And I finally said to my sister, I don't know what's going on with those kids. I don't know what they're doing, but there's something. They're experiencing something, and I just feel inside of me like I want that. I want that too. And my sister goes, me too. And I was like, okay, I'll go back if you will. And she's like, okay, we're so scared. And we're holding hands, and we walk in there, and I walked up to our camp counselor, and I tapped her on her shoulder. And she turned around, and I burst into tears. And I remember thinking, why am I crying? I don't know why I'm crying. And I said, I don't know what those kids have, but I want it too. And you know what? She did not even lay a hand on me. The moment I said, I want it too, and my sister goes, me too, I felt an actual wind come over me, just move over me, and I just fell over. My sister, we fell over, toppled on top of each other, and I began speaking in tongues. I had no idea what was going on, And a little while later, I opened my eyes and I said, "What was that?" And the camp counselor said, "Honey, that's the Holy Ghost." And I said, "The Holy who?" And I was so moved in my heart. I had no words, there was no denying what I was feeling and what I was experiencing. And the next day, it was the last day of the camp. The parents were coming to pick everyone up and they were having a talent show. And I had not signed up for the talent show, but I felt this thing inside of me, like I have to respond. What I just experienced demands a response. It demands something from me. I have to do something. I have to say something. And so I went and I said, "Is it too late? Can I sign up for the talent show?" And they said, "Oh, sure." They put me on. So I was the last one up there. And I got up there. I was so nervous. I hadn't made any friends because I thought they were all so weird. So I didn't know who anyone was. They didn't know who I was. But I get up there and I just said, "Last night, I met love. And I feel that inside of me. And I just have to say, I'm so thankful. And so I just have to give something back. I have to give love back. I have to express it. I can feel it inside of me, and I just have to do something about it." And I sang the only church song that I knew. "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears the hour I first believed. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, God's praise, then when we first begun." It was the only church song that I had learned and knew, and I wept my way through that song, singing that song, and I felt and I meant every single word. I knew and understood exactly what those words meant. Love had found me. Love had saved me. Love had changed me. When I got home, well, first of all, on the way home, I will say, the pastor from the church that sent us actually came and picked me and my sister up. And that poor man, it was about 4 or 5 hour drive, and I talked the whole time. I was 11 years old. I did not stop. I probably wore him out. But I said, "I'm gonna do something big for God. I'm gonna do something big for God. Maybe I'll be a missionary. Maybe I'll start a church. I didn't even know what I was saying, but I could feel something inside of me like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do something for God. He just did something for me. I'm going to do something for him. I'm going to figure it out. I was so excited. I was just, my heart was on fire. And when I got home, I asked my mom if we could go to the church that had sent us to this camp. So she took us on a Sunday night, and the worship started. And when the worship started, I just felt compelled again. I have to respond. I can't just sit here. Like, I have to respond. And so I went to the front. I came up to the altar. I was the only one up there. And I didn't know any of the songs. I didn't know any of the words. And I just lifted my hands and I just started worshiping. I was dancing. I was singing in tongues. I didn't even understand what tongues was, except in my little kid brain, it was, I have a way to talk to Jesus now. That's kind of what I thought in my head. And so I'm just singing in tongues. And after a few moments, a woman came over and she put her hands on my shoulders and she walked me over to a chair and she sat me down. And I was a little confused. I didn't know what happened or why did she do that or why did I do something wrong? Was it not okay? I didn't really know what was happening. And it really kind of bothered me. And we got home and I said to my mom, Mom, why did that woman make me sit down? And my mom, I think she didn't really know what to say. And you know, being a mom now, I know, like, we're all just doing the best we can. We don't always have the answers, but you better believe we're going to act like we do. But my mom said, you got to know when to stop. And I was just kind of shocked when my mom said that. Like, you got to know when to stop. Like, this is something that you control or you make up or, like, what does that mean? Know when to stop. Like, you only encounter God in a certain place, at a camp, or just for a moment, or you don't get to experience God all the time, or, I mean, I just couldn't wrap my head around, what does that mean? And instantly, just like the enemy does, he saw an opportunity. And the enemy came in with shame, so much shame. Look at you. What an idiot. You don't know anything. Why would you do that? Why would you worship like that? Why would you act like that? So much shame, so much guilt, so much embarrassment. And I just instantly shut down. And I remember I put up such a wall in my heart because I had opened up my heart and I had been vulnerable. And I had experienced love, but I felt betrayed. After everything I'd walked through, the men who had abused me, every form of abuse, who had just ripped my heart to pieces, and I had decided no one's going to have access to my heart. No one's going to do this to me again. And then I had this incredible encounter, and I opened up my heart, and I poured out my vulnerability, and I suddenly felt betrayed. And I put up my wall, and I shut down. And do you know, at that moment, I could not even say, I love you anymore. I had never had a problem telling my mom, I love you, Mom, telling my sister, I love you, Amy. I'd never had a problem expressing love or being affectionate, but in that moment, it was such a huge shutdown in my heart that I never would say, I love you anymore after that. I just shut down my heart and love in all ways. Well, not long after this, my mom met an incredible Christian man. His name was George. And George was an awesome believer, a sturdy believer. He was a successful man in business. He had money. He was not extremely rich, but he could pay the bills. He married my mom. He brought us in, and I lived in a house for the first time. He bought us food. I remember the first time he took us to the grocery store, and he said, you can pick out whatever you want. And I said, anything we want? And he said, yeah, pick out whatever you want. I mean, us kids went hog wild. And we did not get those generic brands. We got all the name brands of all the snacks and all the things. We never went hungry again. We never went without. He bought us clothes. I had new clothes. He took me shopping. He would take us shopping regularly and buy us new clothes. He put us in sports. Well, he tried. That's not my forte. He still cheered me on, though, while he was laughing hysterically. tears coming down his face because I'm so bad. And he would always cheer us on, but I had my very shut down heart. And I said to him when we all moved in together, I know what you're going to do. You're going to hurt me and you're going to leave me. You're going to be just like all the other men. Don't look at me. Don't talk to me. I don't like you. I don't want anything to do with you. In fact, I hate you. And you're not my dad. And I don't want anything to do with you. I'm not going to let you hurt me. I'm not going to let you hurt my mom. I'm not going to let you hurt my siblings. I threatened him all the time. It was ridiculous. And my stepdad, he never stopped loving me. In fact, he would get up every single morning and have time with Jesus. And I would wake up, I'm in high school now, and I would walk out there like, you know, and I'd hear him worshiping, and I'd hear him praying out loud. And I'd hear him saying, God, teach me how to love my girls. Teach me how to be a good father to my girls. And I'd be yelling from the other room, I'm not your girl. Quit praying for me. I was so offended. I was like, why doesn't he go do that in a room with a door shut? I want to hear your prayers. I want to hear your worship. I want to hear that. I was so mad. I was so angry. And no matter how many times I kept rejecting him and pushing him away, he just kept loving me. And he just kept moving towards me. And he never faltered in that. And he was truly showing me the love of Jesus before I really knew Jesus. He was an incredible example to me. Well, at one point, my mom, she pulled me aside, and her and George sat down with me, and they said, honey, you don't need to take care of me anymore. George is here, and he's taking care of us. And you're a kid. Just go be a kid. And I felt like the room was spinning. I'm sorry, what? Go be a kid? Go be a kid? I left childhood a long time ago. Those men took my childhood. How do I be a kid? What does that even mean? I don't know how to be a kid. And this was my identity, to protect and take care of my mom. And if you take that away from me, who am I? What do I do? What's the point of my life? What's the purpose of my life? And I was so angry. The anger inside of me just built and grew even more. It was bubbling up inside of me. It was getting worse. And I was in so much pain. I was tormented at night. I would have nightmares all the time. And this was just getting built up more and more and more until it was bubbling over. And I was in my senior year of high school, and I could not take it anymore. If I don't get to protect my mom and take care of her, what is the point? And my childhood is gone. I don't know how to be a kid. I don't know how to do that. I don't know how to be carefree or play or anything else. It's done. And so when my family was gone, they'd left me home alone because I had a track meet, and I was by myself at home, and I said, this is it. And I overdosed. I wanted to end my life, and I tried. And I woke up on the floor, and I was stunned. When I woke up a few hours later, I'm awake. I'm in my home. And I look around. There's no sign of me getting sick. I felt fine. I didn't have a headache. I didn't have a stomach ache. Like, there's nothing. It was as if it didn't even happen. And I was so shocked. In my total shock, I just said, okay, God, okay, I believe you're real, and I will give you my life, but please, you have got to set me free. I cannot live in this torment any longer. I cannot live with this pain and this anger any longer. Please, set me free. And I had no idea the prayer that would lead me on, the journey it would take me on. I was out in my backyard one day shortly after this, and I was praying and talking to Jesus, and I felt like the Lord dropped in my heart, Redding, California. I knew that was God because I'd never heard of the place. And so I looked it up and I saw, okay, it's a town, Northern California. I did a little research. I saw that they had a Christian university there, Simpson University. And I was really late in admissions, but I called and I said, I know this is late, but I just got saved. And I was wondering if I could go to your school. I'm almost done with high school. And to my surprise, they pulled some strings. They let me in. And I go to this school. And wow. First of all, let me just say, back in that time, Simpson was very conservative. I don't mean politically. I mean, like, quiet. And I was a new Christian. I didn't know I was supposed to stop cussing. I didn't know the rules about being a Christian. I got in trouble all the time. They also had a belief about women. And when one boy came up to me and said, why are you even bothering being here at college? Because women are just supposed to get married and have babies and be at home. I was like, coming across the table at that guy. I got in trouble a lot in school. It was not really the place for me. I had no friends. My GPA was a 1.2 because they do not know how to teach geniuses like myself. It was miserable. And in the middle of the night, I am driving and I'm crying and I'm going, why am I here? Why did you bring me here, God? What am I doing? And I drove, I'm trying to go back to the school. I turned the wrong way and I drove right up a hill to a road that dead end at a church. It was Bethel Church. And at that time, this is in the year 2000. It's a long time ago. At that time, they had just built the prayer house. It's this house that's got windows all around it. It's open for prayer 24 hours. And there were people inside in the middle of the night. They were, well, I guess praying. I didn't know this at the time. I just see people in there doing weird stuff like this. And again, I thought, what a bunch of weirdos. But I drove around and I'm like, oh, this is a church. Okay. So I was kind of curious. I was like, I should come check this out on Sunday. So I came on Sunday to check out the church. And I ended up turning around and running out after like one song because I was like, whoa, this is a little much for me. I don't know what's happening in this place. And at that time, they had like the older women's dance team that danced on the side of the stage and wore these long gowns with sequined tunics over the top and like tambourines with ribbons. And then they'd have like this young girls dance team that would come running out and they were wearing bandanas and overalls. And they're like really dramatic. And there was like every kind of instrument on the stage. I'm pretty sure I saw a guy blowing a shell. Like it was wild. And I was like, this might be a little much for me, maybe. But you know what? There was something familiar when I was in that place. Something familiar, like way back at Camp Corley. There was someone familiar in that place. And I felt the pull to go back. So I ended up going back. And this time I met someone. I met a girl who went to the college. She ended up discipling me because I was like, why do you do this? Why do you do this? Why do you do this? She introduced me to Banning, who at the time was a youth pastor. And Banning was the one who started Jesus Culture. The first Jesus Culture was in 1999. I showed up in 2000. I was helping, but in 2000 when I was there, I was leading a team out on the street for evangelism because that was kind of my thing. Like, I'm ready to tell people about Jesus because what he did in my life. And the short version of that, because that's a really long part of this story, but I'm going to kind of pull it into this. When I got connected with Banning, I finished my year at the college. I ended that. I decided to go to the school ministry at the church. The school ministry had just started. It was only in like its third year. It was very small. I did the school for 2 years. And the goodness of God, he brought people to me who saw and recognized I needed help and I needed healing. And that prayer that I had prayed, God set me free. I'll give you my life if you set me free. This was the answer. He brought people who walked me through inner healing and counseling. I spent the next few years mostly on the floor, bawling my eyes out and truly getting transformed by the work of the cross in my life. I was having to walk through forgiveness, walk through repentance. I was going through deliverance. I was going through it all. After all of the inner healing stuff, then I was in counseling for a long time and going, well, how do healthy people deal with anger? How do healthy people deal with sorrow? How do healthy people deal with whatever it is? Like, I was relearning everything because all of my tools in my tool belt were broken. Everything that I had to deal with life came from a very messed up world. So I had to get new tools so I could deal with my world in a healthy way, in the way that Jesus wants me to. And so I spent so long going through all of this. And in the midst of that, the Lord was slowly pulling me into worship. Now, I grew up singing. I liked singing. I never excelled in it. I never even would have thought it'd be something I'd do with my life. In fact, when I was in choir in high school, I got in trouble and I got kicked out of choir. And then he banned me from the rest of high school. So I was never in choir. I never did singing there. And then at Simpson College, they had auditions for the worship team. And I thought, maybe this is how I could make friends. I don't really know much about worship, but I know how to sing. So maybe I could audition. So I did, as a background singer. I did not make the team. So I was not thinking that there was anything special about singing or anything like that. But all of a sudden, someone walked by me, the worship pastor. He came back and he said, do you want to sing? And I'm like, who are you? He's like, I'm the worship pastor. And he's like, I don't even know. Who are you? I'm Kim. How'd you know I sing? I don't. Okay. Well, it was just a God thing. So I just started singing background vocals. And then it's like, hey, why don't you lead a song? The first time I led a song on a Sunday morning, I messed up horribly. I burst into tears and I ran off the stage in the middle of the song. I left the whole band. I just left them. Abandoned everyone. I did not go back up. And I swore I would never do it again. Because I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. This is too hard. And in that time, in that process, God was building something inside of me and bringing me into worship. But it all started with teaching me first about who he is and building up something inside of me, building up an internal world that could be ready for my external world that he was about to bring. And all of a sudden, one day, I just felt like, okay, I've been leading worship a little bit. I'm growing. There's things happening. But I feel locked up. Something inside of me needs to shift and change. Something needs to come out. I don't know what it is, but something needs to come out. And so I went on a journey. I left Reading and I started traveling around the U.S. where I had heard God was doing something awesome. And I would just show up in these places and just sit there and wait. I'm just waiting, God, for you to do something. Something needs to come out of me. Maybe this is where it will come out. Nothing was happening. I landed in Charlotte, North Carolina, and there I heard a song that changed my life.
For me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Jealous for me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind. eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. By the grace in his eyes, if grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. So heaven meets earth like a sloppy wet kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. He loves us. Oh, how he loves us.
I had such an encounter with Jesus when I heard that song. My friend John Mark McMillan wrote that song. And when I came back to California, we were having a Jesus Culture conference, and Banning asked me to lead the worship, and I said, I got to do this song. And I sang that song, and that song ended up, we recorded it. There's a YouTube video. A kid put it on YouTube, actually. It's at like 26 million views now. It went viral, and that's what launched Jesus Culture out in the world and inevitably launched my career. I was working as a banker, actually. I processed loans, and I had to leave my banking career to step into ministry full-time when everything kind of took off, and I did not regret that decision, obviously. But while I was, fast forward, I'm kind of skipping a lot here, but fast forward, and now Jesus Culture, we're going all over the earth doing conferences and tours and all these different things. It was never just worship for us. It was always ministry as well. And we ended up in Brazil. We were on a tour there, and I had two boys at this time. My boys are only, 15 months apart. They're 14 months. I had them back to back, which I don't recommend, FYI. It's kind of crazy. No one told me. I had my babies down in Brazil, my husband there with me, and we're on tour, and my mom calls. And the part of the story that I haven't said yet is that George was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. And it was so hard for me that when I finally got all the healing and I finally got healed and I was ready for relationship with this man who really had been a father to me and the father I so desperately wanted, he got sick and everything started declining. And while I was in Brazil, my mom called and said, Kim, George got sent into hospice. You need to come home. And I didn't understand what that meant or what she was talking about. And I was like, okay, well, I'm on tour right now, Mom. I'll just come home when we're done. She called me back a day later and she said, Kim, you don't understand. He's waiting for you. You need to come home.
And so we left Brazil right away, and we came home. I got there, and I realized, I don't know why, but I had been so scared to tell George really what was in my heart. I think I was afraid to be vulnerable again, especially to a father. And I sat with him, and I said, George, thank you for loving me. Thank you for praying for me. I'm a worship leader because you taught me how to worship. I'm a Christian because you showed me Jesus before I knew who Jesus was. You changed my life. You rescued me. And I thanked him. And he opened his eyes and he said, sing my favorite song. It was a song called Healing Oil. It was his favorite song because George, he never stopped worshiping and he never stopped asking God to heal him. He never stopped believing that. He never stopped declaring that that's who God was. And Parkinson's is such a cruel disease. When his body began to twist and curl up and he could no longer lift his hands, he would lift his wrist. When his mouth could no longer open and he couldn't talk, he would mumble and he would just hum and he would just keep worshiping. He never stopped. And even on his deathbed, before he went to Jesus, he wanted to worship. And not just worship, but he wanted to declare that God is a God who heals. Even in the midst of that. And when he passed away, I really wrestled inside myself. I'm a worship leader. I'm getting up on this stage and I'm singing songs about healing and who God is. And he did not heal George. And no one likes to talk about those things. They're hard things that we don't have a lot of answers for. We don't have great answers. The Bible's not clear about some of those things. The only thing it's clear about is that we're required to live in the mystery and walk in faith and trust God. And I had to take a step back, and I just felt like I was in all this mess and all this anger and all this pain. And I could feel Jesus knocking on that door and saying, Kim, let me in to this moment with you. Let me in. And I think I was also feeling the regret of not having the time with George. I missed out. I missed out because I was in pain, and it took me a long time to get there. And then by the time I got there, it was kind of too late. And that was really hard to reconcile. And when I felt Jesus saying, let me in, I kind of felt like, I can't let you see me in this mess. Again, I'm afraid to be vulnerable. I'm afraid to open up my heart and to like let you into this mess. And Jesus, he showed me that this was the only way to freedom. This is the only way out. You have to let me in to that mess. I don't need perfection. I don't need you to figure it out. I'm going to do this with you. And he gave me this song, and this was the song that carried me through that time.
In the front lines, you fight for me. Oh, your kindness is my shield. When the armies rise and I am scared, my heart you will defend. You in the trap. tragedy, you grieve with me. Your comfort is my song. In my wandering, you're still rescuing. You will never, never give up. You are on my side. You go before me. You stand behind. You tell couldn't see, when I couldn't feel, when the pain was real, you were on my side. You were on my side. When you saved me from my heart of stone, you awoke these bones, you were on my side.
George taught me so much about worship, so much. I figured it out like later, you know, really. It's like it really kind of hit me how much I really learned from him in that, and worshiping him in the hardest of circumstances, and how important it is to worship him in the worst of times, in the best of times, like to never stop, to keep going. And, you know, a really thing that really bothered me was that I always wanted to ask him, why did you marry my mom? Like, it really bothered me. Like, I mean, I love my mom. I think she's awesome. But, I mean, she was like a woman with some baggage, you know? She had three kids who, not just any kids, but crazy kids who were mad, who had just been through a lot. Like, I didn't understand. Like, to me, George just seemed like this incredible, put together, had it all figured out man, and then married this woman mainly with her crazy kids. And I didn't understand, and I never got to ask him that. And one day I was talking to the Lord about it, and I said, God, I wish I could have asked him that. That's my one regret. And I heard God say, I sent him for you. And I said, you love me that much that you said, I'm going to save this girl. I'm going to send someone who's going to change her life and bring this girl out. It's like he knew what the destiny on my life, and he was determined. Nothing is going to steal that. And I'm going to bring someone in. I'm going to set things up. I'm going to bring the pieces together. You will not miss what you are called for and created for. His promises are yes and amen. So I'm going to wrap it up here. We're going to do one more song, but before I say that, so I've given you the concise version of what God has done in my life, and there's a full version. It's a book called Brave Surrender. You can get it on Amazon. I should have brought some today, and I forgot, but I think there's a QR code that they're going to put up maybe for that. Maybe. Ready? And now. And now. Oh, it worked.
Nice.
So if you want to hear the full version, you could get the book. If you like reading books, I promise it's not too long for you non-readers. You'll like it. But here we are now, me and my husband and three kids now. I got a little girl. We live in Montana. And now the place that we're at is, you know what? We are taking on fear in our own lives. I feel like God sent us out into the wilderness to do something inside of us, and then he's getting ready to launch us into something new. So the thing that's burning in my heart now is, you know, I'm very uncomfortable with the fact that worship music, it's very different from when I very first started, okay? So it's been a lot of years. You heard the story, like 2000 was when I first showed up. But anyways, worship music is now in the industry, the worship music industry. It's really uncomfortable to me, just being honest. And I don't necessarily like that. I don't really think worship music should be in the industry. And I think there's some things that need to shift and change. I think that there's a better way. I think there's a different way. I think that there's just something different to be out there. And so it's funny, I feel a little bit like Moses. You know, he had this destiny and this calling. He ends up out in the desert. There he meets God. God does some work and then says, now go back and shake up the house and clean house. And that's what he did. And that's what we're getting ready to do. It's a little nerve-wracking, I gotta be honest. So we're constantly facing our fears. And this song that we're gonna close with is a song that I wrote for my son, my middle son, when he was dealing with fear. And a song that just reminds us that fear, it says in the song, fear could never conquer me because you already have. And so when you're surrendered to Jesus, he's gonna be the one to make sure we give our lives to him. And it says in Proverbs, man makes his plans, but the Lord aligns his steps. God's the one who plans it out. Why don't you guys go ahead and stand? We're just going to sing this one last song.
Jesus Christ, King of all, everything at your name has to fall. Runs at the sound, everything at your name has to bow. Peace has overcome my heart, so worry never came. Hope has taken back that space disappointment had. I believe your promises above my circumstance. Fear could never conquer me, 'cause you already have. Oh, you already have. Jesus Christ, King of all, everything at your name has to fall. Peace has overcome my heart, so worry never can. Hope has taken back that space disappointment had. I believe your promises above my circumstance. Fear could never conquer me, 'cause you already have. All the way through the night, you've got armies of angels assigned to my life. I've got nothing to fear. I surrender the fight to the one who is greater right here by my side. I've got nothing to fear all the way through the night. You've got armies of angels assigned to my life. I've got nothing to fear. I surrender the fight to the one who is greater right here by my side. I've got nothing to fear. Peace has overcome my heart, so worry never can. Hope has taken back thy space, disappointment had. I believe your promises above my circumstance. Fear could never conquer me, 'cause you already have. Oh, peace has overcome my heart, so worry never can. Hope has taken back thy space, disappointment had. I believe your promises above my circumstance. Fear could never conquer me, 'cause you already have. Fear could never conquer me, 'cause you already have. Oh, fear could never conquer me, 'cause you